700 lions.
But this is, and you know, this is interesting because there's a student in, I think it was the afternoon class, not this class, in one of her answers to one of the questions, I forget what it was, but it made the statement, well, everybody does have a Bible in their language, right? And I'm thinking, no, not quite. There are still thousands of people groups that do not have a language, a Bible in their language. Okay.
I actually went to the same school, high school, as Hal.
Yeah,
I know his brother, David, better. We're in the same class.
Hunter High School.
Yeah, it was kind of a coincidence because I didn't know where I was coming, you know, which church. So I remember David saying, oh, yeah, Hal's in Shanghai. So I just emailed him saying, oh, yeah, I'm going to be there. Should I say hi? And it turned out the same congregation. So, yeah, my wife and I, we were in Indonesia. She's also Korean-American, grew up in New Jersey. Yeah, Jersey girl. So we have two children that were born in Indonesia. They're all in Philadelphia now. Yeah, Eagles. But I'll start off with a word of prayer before we begin. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity just to learn what you're doing around the world. And Lord, there are so many remarkable, unexpected, amazing things that are happening. You're bringing people to faith, to you, Lord. We just pray as we learn more about what's happening around the world. Lord, let us just remember how, despite circumstances, you are still in control. Lord, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. And I should explain that I didn't know that we'd be skipping ahead to from lesson
six to
14. And so, yeah, feel free to stop me at any time to ask questions. And just to kind of introduce some of the themes before we get into an overview of the readings, we're going to cover something called the Great Matrix. And the Great Matrix is just a tool to kind of map out where people are in their journey of faith. And it was developed by someone, well, Frank Gray. And he's with a Far Eastern Broadcasting Company. They do like radio programs, shortwave radio. And he was in Laos for a long time, working among the Buddhists there. He felt like they weren't really effective in their programming, in their outreach to Buddhists there. And this is just, these slides will be given to David and he can share them with you. So don't worry about taking notes unless there's something you want to write down. Slides will be given to you. And so for a long time there was a scale, I don't know if you can read it, but the specific descriptions aren't important, but just they have no understanding of faith, no awareness of God to growth in Christ, maturity in Christ. And for a long time people, when they were doing outreach evangelism, they'd say, oh, this person is at this level or that level, just to kind of gauge where they are. But what he and others discovered was it wasn't really that effective just having a single axis. And so he realized that another important aspect was how open they were. And so don't worry, you can review this file on your own. What he did was he combined them to create a Y and an X axis. And so we created a matrix.
Can you see that?
Yes. And so there are four different quadrants, A, B, C, D, and I'll just quickly cover them. And so quadrant A is, they're generally closed toward the gospel, ignorant of it, they have very little knowledge. They reject the gospel message, and they're possibly opposed to evangelism, hostile to Christians and church activity. And so that's like, yeah, they're very closed, have a negative attitude towards faith, towards the gospel, as well as very ignorant, or they have little knowledge or understanding of God, the gospel, the Bible.
Is there criteria that puts people in a quadrant, or is that just all subjective?
Oh, well, you kind of... I mean, it's somewhat subjective. There are questions or characteristics that you can develop. He may have developed them, but just this is more general. You wouldn't say, oh, he's 0.5 or 0.9. I mean, you just kind of make an assumption based on your interactions with them. And the benefit, to jump ahead, is to kind of figure out where they are and kind of figure out what's the best ministry or outreach for a group of people in a specific quadrant. And so quadrant B is, and it'll make sense why this is helpful very soon. People are open towards the gospel. They're hungry or eager to learn more. They're accepting of this message. And they're somewhat welcoming of Christian activity and engagement, but they don't really have a lot of knowledge or understanding. And so we would normally consider them to be seekers or just open, but not mature. And they're considered a ripe harvest field. Quadrant C is follower of Jesus, member of a Christian fellowship. They're growing in faith. They're active. They share God's blessings, and they're bringing others. They're sharing their faith with others and bringing others to faith. And quadrant D, they have a lot of knowledge, but they're difficult because they experience a closeness to Christ, but have fallen away. Negative or indifferent towards Christians and church, and they're cold spiritually.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
What about people who are more knowledge, tons of knowledge, open to Christianity, but they're also open to all other religions?
They would...
I feel like it goes in C, but it's not really C.
Yeah, C would be like a deep and mature faith. If they're just somewhat pluralistic, they're probably closer to D than C.
But
I mean,
they're still
open
to it.
Yeah.
Actually, well, I was thinking, I could see China being B and America being D.
Yeah, a lot of people would say Europe is definitely D now, mostly, and America seems to be trending towards D. But what's helpful is it's just kind of figuring out where people are at and just finding the right ministry approach or outlook on where they're at. A simple way to put it is, this is a more realistic approach. A lot of people, when you meet people who are not knowledgeable, have no understanding, are closed, like very anti-Christian, you kind of, without realizing, a lot of ministries kind of jump to, well, they're going to become very mature and very knowledgeable. But that's generally unrealistic. I mean, you know, there could be miraculous visions or God works in their hearts and they automatically become this great believer. But generally, most people, they have to become somewhat open first, and then they grow in faith and knowledge. So this is generally a more realistic journey of faith for people. And the reason why this is helpful is, if you know that people are very anti-Christian, anti-faith, anti-Bible, you kind of have to start off with just kind of opening opportunities and opening their hearts, helping them just to become more receptive. Does that make sense?
Yes, but that pluralistic question is not answered yet.
I think.
Sorry.
No.
I'm asking because I feel like my dad is very open. He's very knowledgeable in the faith and scriptures and stories, but he's definitely not in that quadrant. He's not a believer.
Some people would say maybe he's more in quadrant B. Like, he is open and he's knowledgeable, maybe like towards the middle or the top area.
I don't know if you can see the arrow. No, you can't.
Where N is, the letter N, but not like a mature believer. Because generally speaking, people would think if you're a mature believer, then you would focus on the gospel and biblical faith rather than. But yeah, that's open to interpretation. What they also discovered was people in quadrant D, people who are from a church background or a Christian background, and they either for a number of reasons, sometimes they've been hurt, they've had negative experiences with church or Christians, they become very anti-Christian, and they're often more difficult to reach than people in quadrant A. And so this is just, if this is helpful in any of your ministries, what they discover in these media ministries and other ministries, those people in quadrant D who've been hurt by the the church or by Christians, they need more one-on-one time. That's what they discovered. Whereas people in quadrant B, like seekers and people who are open, large, wide-scale, like media ministries are very effective in reaching them. But the key principle that I hope that you can take from this is a lot of times, especially for people who are, and most unreached people and if are in quadrant A.
A again is?
Oh, very little knowledge and closed.
Closed. J, where this J
is. Yeah, where the letter J is. Unreached people do, it just generally means people who have not received the gospel message, don't know about it, haven't had anyone share the Bible or their faith or their testimony. I think this is an estimate, but somewhere around 80-85% of the people in the world, particularly in, you can correct me if anyone knows the exact statistic, actually don't know anyone who's a follower of Jesus directly. So the majority, now that must be an unreached area, sorry, because there are a lot of Christians. And so in unreached areas, I think the general estimate is around 80-85% of people don't have a personal relationship with someone who is a follower of Jesus. And so a lot of them are in quadrant A, the letter J. Any questions about?
Why are they closed?
Well, partly they have no knowledge, and partly, it could be different religious backgrounds, Hindu, Muslim, Buddhist. Historically, they found that most of the people who have become believers or Christians are from an animistic background, and people from like major world religions, there's been less fruitfulness in those areas until recently.
What has changed recently?
We can cover some of these articles. We'll touch upon that.
Sorry.
Partly it's a work of God, because a lot of these ideas were proposed in the past centuries ago when some of these methods and ministries have been done in the past on a smaller scale. But definitely in the Islamic world, the past 20 years has just been, there's just been a huge response in ways that no one ever imagined. My background, my ministry background in Indonesia is working with they would say fundamentalist Muslims. Mm-hmm. And so, even among extremists, there's been a response to faith. So,
yeah.
Any questions? Okay. So, these are just direct. I'm a Mac guy, so these touchpads are hard for me. Okay, here we go. So these are just direct quotes from the readings, and you'll get the slide too, these files. And so how many people have done the readings for lesson 14? Okay, I'll just quickly, these are my personal, like, Cliff Notes version, really. I hope you still read the articles. But one article is about a church in every people. And so the author, a missiologist, McGavran, he just, that it shouldn't be, the goal of ministry shouldn't be an isolated church, but it should be a cluster of growing churches. And he uses a term which was new to me, conglomerate church, conglomerate congregation. And he kind of defines it here, where it's more of members of different segments of society. They just kind of come together, but they have no real, like, social ties or no real connections to each other. And so it's good for that congregation, but once they leave their community, social network, it's harder to connect and reach out and share their faith with people in their own community. Now, I'll give an example, a case study from Vancouver. How many people are skiers or snowboarders? Okay. How many people have been to Whistler? Oh, great. Okay, so he's an assistant pastor at a church in Whistler. And we met him, my wife and I, when we were doing a training right outside of Vancouver. So I was curious. We were, my wife and I were snowboarders, which was the reason why we did our training in Vancouver. The food's great too. And so we asked, oh, so what do you do as a pastor, as an assistant pastor in Whistler? And he said, his ministry focus was reaching out to the seasonal workers who come to Whistler every year. And they're pretty much young people, they're have a good time, more or less the party, honestly. Mm-hmm. But he said, through his ministry, through the church's ministry to these seasonal workers, every year, 50 to 80 people come to faith. And these are kind of like people come to party. They're not really open, generally open to faith, or they're not there to go, oh, I want to become a Christian or go to Bible study. You know, people don't go to Whistler for that. And so it was an amazing ministry. And we asked him, so what do you do? How do you reach these people, these seasonal workers? And he said, he goes to Whistler and he skis, he snowboards, and he talks to people, and he shops at the gift shops and eats at the restaurants. That's like a dream job. I mean, and, you know, you get to do have all that fun. It's like a year-long vacation, and then you also do ministry. And really, even though it's an unusual and amazing case study, it's reaching out to a specific group of people with similar connections. And it's very easy for those seasonal workers just to invite another seasonal worker because they're working and hanging out all the time. They have shared interests. And so even if, you know, they don't meet at Bible study, because they have all these connection throughout the week. I mean, they see each other, they can encourage each other, they can invite other people who are from a similar background. It's just very easy and simple. And so that's an example from North America where it's, you know, it doesn't have to be like a specific ethnic group always, but it could just be people from a similar group. So yeah.
But isn't that, would that be a conglomerate church?
Well, in some ways, because they could be from different ethnic groups, different countries, but because they're from a similar like societal group. Mm-hmm. I mean, in most places, they talk about, and there'll be examples here, a specific ethnic group, or like in India, like a specific caste. So, yeah. So, the goal is just to have a cluster of congregations, not just one, but always growing and always reaching out. And in most places, it's easier to concentrate on one people, and people generally say one ethnic group, but it could be a specific caste. I think there's an example of a group of taxi drivers in the article, and that's just another specific social group, a group of taxi drivers and their families. And so they already have these social networks, these connections, and they see each other on a regular basis. And they share similar issues, similar struggles, concerns. Any questions? I'm just zooming through this, so feel free to ask questions. And the one benefit, one key advantage to this is because they have similar connections and networks and family networks or work networks, they can kind of stay where they are. I mean, they're still believers, followers of Jesus, but they're work connections, their social connections are still the same, so they still have an opportunity to share faith, share their testimonies, and reach out to people who are still from their natural networks. And so, and related to that, because they're part of the same network, they're still connected, and they can encourage each other as a group, even when they face opposition, persecution, or other things. There was an example in Algeria, where there was a house church in Algeria, but they were arrested. A group of them were arrested, and as they were being interrogated by the authorities, they decided as a group, well, we'll just face these, you know, issues together. And the authorities, even though, you know, the government and everything else, there's so many more of them, so much more powerful, because there were dozens of people, house church leaders in Algeria, they just said, okay, we'll let you continue. And that was an amazing, no one expected that to happen. So yeah, Algeria of all places. Yeah, where we normally think of Islamic extremism and other issues. And, yeah. And because they're still connected to their social networks, you still have this constant natural connection, and they can continue to reach out to their own, you know, communities. They're not in a new community where they don't really know people, but they're still in their communities, and they can continue to share their faith, even though they're facing opposition and persecution because they have fellow brothers and sisters in Christ from their, you know, similar backgrounds, similar networks. They still continue to share and reach out to others. And one thing is, another principle is that they should have this hope and this, what's the term they're using? Big, hairy goals. just huge dreams and visions and mission statements for what they want. Like, even though they could be a small minority within their network or their community, they feel like God will use them to reach the rest of their community. So, I'm just going to jump ahead to an example from South Asia. Are there any questions about the previous topic? No. Okay, and so lesson 14, there are a lot of articles and readings from an Islamic context. And so more and more, and this might be pretty technical or deep, so feel free to ask a lot of questions. There's a growing number of Muslims who are coming to faith in Jesus, and sometimes they refer to themselves as Muslim followers of Jesus, and they continue, in some cases, they even preach the gospel in mosques and Islamic, like Quranic schools, like the madrasa. And so this is happening. It's being researched and documented, but it's obviously kind of new, and you know, people are trying to figure it out. So several of the articles are on that topic. Has anyone here heard about these developments or ministries?
Okay. I've heard a little bit about it.
There's a website and a book, windinthehouse.org, and it was done by David Garrison. He did a global research project where he interviewed all these different movements, and he discovered that in the past 20 years, I think there are like 65 movements to Christ among Muslim groups all around the world. And he defined, the criteria he used was at least 1,000 baptisms and 100 like fellowships. That was the minimum criteria. And they're in all the crazy places too. And so I'll send the website if people want to look at it. But in the past 20 years, there are all these movements among Muslims. And so there are a few case studies in lesson 14. And so in this particular case, there's someone who, I'll just simply touch on some of the principles or repeated themes. In a lot of these articles, they refer to people who come to an understanding of Jesus or a curiosity. They're seeking more information about, more knowledge about Jesus. And one of the repeated themes is Islamic scholars and theological instructors, as they study the Quran and Quranic commentaries, they come to the conclusion that Jesus cannot be just a prophet. Do you remember the book Evidence That Demands a Verdict by Josh McDowell? It's kind of like, he was a skeptic. I think he was an atheist, and he, you know, studied the Bible and related resources, historical works, just to disprove Christianity. But he came to the conclusion that Jesus was either a raving lunatic or he really is the Son of God. And that's used in a lot of churches, a lot of Christian circles. But, I mean, these Islamic leaders and scholars, they came to a similar conclusion from the Quran. And the reason is, and feel free to ask questions. The Quran refers to Jesus as the only one who's blameless and sinless, born of a virgin, coming back as, and some people would say as intercessor. Even some of the arguments about Jesus not being crucified, other Islamic scholars would say, no, the Quran does say he was crucified. There are all these debates and issues, but the bottom line is they come to the conclusion that something doesn't add up. Jesus can't be all of this, as described in the Quran, and just be a person, a regular man. And so they're eager to learn more. And so some are interested in learning more, and they're interested in scripture. Yes?
I read the Quran, but this Jesus was just a prophet.
Yes.
They put Muhammad in the same position as Jesus.
Yes.
I don't came to the conclusion that he is the son of God.
Oh, no, there are verses that, refer to, like, God has no begotten. But from the, like, there are just a few verses, or some verses about Jesus, Isa, and they come to the conclusion, there must be something more. there are verses in the Quran that refer to that instruct Muslims to study the Gospels and the Torah, and the Psalms, and so they're eager to learn more, and they realize that something must be different about Jesus than the other prophets. But and so this has come out in a lot of the testimonies of a lot of these believers who are from a Muslim background. So it's true. In the Quran, it doesn't say Jesus is the Son of God. It's more from their own personal study that they feel like something's missing. Jesus can't be just a regular person.
I'm not sure. It's okay.
Okay. No, and it's
everyone
true.
Has
and it's a minority view. It's not the majority view in Islam, for sure. So, yeah. But that's kind of the background. And if you even Google, or sorry, not Google, you do an online search for Muslim dreams of a man in white, a lot of Muslims are having dreams of Isa al-Masih, which is the Arabic Quranic name for Jesus the Messiah. And so, yeah. Anyway, that's all to say there are all these people, Muslims, coming to faith in Jesus. So many of the articles are discussing that this issue, these movements.
These Muslims coming to faith, if there was one here and I was having a talk with him, would his Christianity be the same, his theology be the same as my theology?
Not exactly. There's a book where someone interviewed a lot of these Muslim followers of Jesus to find out what they believe. And for most topics, they're very conservative, like from a biblical perspective. The issue becomes about how close are Islam and Christianity. Like, a lot of Christians would say they're not close at all, a lot of Muslims would say they're not close at all. But these new believers would say there's a lot of overlap. So, yeah. I'm trying to think of what else. There are other issues of, yes, even the Son of God issue. They wouldn't use the term Son of God, they would use something else, and that's been another issue for discussion and debate. Let me feel free, as we're going through this issue, this topic, feel free to ask questions. And if this is kind of too heavy, I can go into a case study which kind of describes more.
What's happening is that the projector is on the laptop, and so that light from the projector reflecting on a laptop.
Oh,
like,
I see.
Right across.
Okay, I thought people just wanted a better view. Okay. is this now blinding other people? I'll do it this way.
That's fine.
Maybe
pull the projector
this way.
That's
fine.
Yeah. Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. And so this is just an example of one person's testimony. And it's pretty much like he became a follower of Jesus after comparing the Quran and the Bible. And his father rejected him and so forth. And part of the issue in South Asia is a lot of the believers are from a Hindu background, and a lot of the terminology in Christian Bibles in South Asia, in India and Pakistan, use a lot of Hindu terms, like the Hindu term. Like, pretty much it's, do you use the Muslim term for God, or do you use the Hindu term for God, and other religious terminology? And so Muslims, when they see all these Hindu terms, they think it's polytheism. So it's a complicated issue. I mean, generally in any language, it's what term do you use for God and for theological terms. It's very complicated. And yeah. I could talk about that for hours, but I won't. And so this is one example of when they start to translate the Bible, they, this person from a Muslim background realized that a lot of terms were foreign to the Muslim community, a lot of theological terms. And so they started working through some of the terms that were primarily from a Hindu background, Hindu religious terms. And for Muslims, you know, that was a huge issue for them. And so when they started using more Arabic loanwords, it became more acceptable. Now, just as an example, I would say in Indonesia, which is the most populous Muslim country, a lot of the Bible the Christian Bible in Indonesia uses a lot of Arabic loan words. Some of the denominations use the name Allah in the name of their denomination, Assemblies of God, Gereja, Sidang-Sidang, Jemaat, Allah. That's the official name of the denomination in Indonesia. So, yeah, it's a complicated issue. But once they started changing some of the religious terminology and some of the names to Arabic terms, Muslims became more open. And a lot of times, when some of these Muslim believers, followers of Jesus, looked at some of the old historic Jewish and the old, like early church practices, they see a lot of similarities to, like, you know, the prayers and praying while they're kneeling rather than. And so they look at a lot of similarities and they emphasize those similarities to kind of explain, oh, the different forms of worship and how similar they were historically. Rather than now. And this is one of the interpretations where normally in Islam they regard Muhammad as the final prophet and the one who is above all previous prophets. But these Muslim followers of Jesus, as they study the Quran and some of the commentaries, they say that's what they were taught, but they don't think it makes sense to them. So they feel like Jesus must be greater than Muhammad. Now, that's, for some of these people, it's one of their internal struggles as they're working through their issues of faith. Even though they're from an Islamic background, as from their own Quranic study, they realize Jesus must be greater than Muhammad. But initially, they don't want to state that publicly because most likely in some of these restrictive places, they will be killed. So,
What in their studies, what kind of a few major points that make them think about Jesus being a higher prophet than Muhammad?
Very few people will state this openly, but the scholars know that Muhammad was not sinless. But they can't say that publicly. If they say Muhammad was a sinner, they would probably be killed by mobs. Like, you know, like. But in the Quran it says Jesus was blameless and sinless. That alone, you know, puts them above Muhammad in their minds, but they can't say that publicly. Jesus was the only one born of a virgin. That's a miracle. Muhammad wasn't born of a virgin. And so, like, they know they're supposed to consider Muhammad greater, but they have a hard time with it as they're studying. And this is the other part. Some of the Quranic commentaries written before the Crusades are very open about Jesus and the Bible. After the Crusades, they become very anti-Christian, anti-Bible, more so than before. And so in some of the more fundamentals in the sense of, you know, pre-modern Islamic schools, they're studying these older medieval commentaries. And they come, I mean, some of these commentaries refer to Isa al-Masih, Jesus, the Messiah, as the sanctifier of their souls. They won't say this publicly. The scholars are discussing it themselves. So, yeah. I was shocked when they told me about this. And there was one commentary, there's a verse in the Quran where the angel Gabriel is talking to the Virgin Mary, referring to, yeah, this is a blessing from God, you'll have a son. And there's a commentary in Indonesia that refers to Jesus as the Most High, which is understood as God. It's not explicitly God, but it's a term that would only be used for God. So it's an indirect way of saying he's God. But regular Muslims don't know that. The scholars know this. It's one of those things where the scholars are discussing these really remarkable topics that you would never imagine conservative Muslims to be discussing, but they are. Is anyone here an academic? Sociology? Even some of the academic Quranic studies, there's a book written by someone from Notre Dame. Sorry if I'm rambling on about this. The biblical subtext of the Quran. And Islamic scholars are involved in those studies, but regular Muslims don't know about it. Does that make sense? Yeah, it's surprising.
Are there any particular books you would recommend? I've read a few myself.
Well, the book, When the House of Islam, gives a good overview. There are a few other books. If there's specific topics, I can send out a list. sorry, yeah, I didn't talk about this. From a Hindu, I think this is from a Hindu background, North India. So this is also happening in Hindu areas as well, not just Muslim areas, but a church planter. They were just doing things, and they were being effective, like, you know, starting congregations here and there. But after reading about different ministries around the world, and they believe that God kind of directed them to try different ministries, types of ministries, they just yeah, 8 churches planted, started in a year, and then soon there were 48 and hundreds more, and over 1,000. And so their mission organization said, "You're lying, you're exaggerating." They sent people to check it out. And yeah, it was true. Now, I should explain, you know, in a lot of these places, a fellowship, like a house church group or small group, is considered a church. So it's not, they're large, they're just a lot of small groups, like cell groups almost. And, and this is also true in the North India example, but more and more, a lot of missionary organizations are focusing on movements, like not just individual congregations or fellowships, but just they want it to grow. And they want people to be always sharing their faith and multiplying. And so in North Africa, this the authors here, they're very involved in, the author was the director of a mission organization, executive director. They were in North Africa, and they were doing a lot of ministry to Muslims. And what they found out was what they considered the typical way, or the way they were always taught to do it or trained to do it, was centered around the missionary. And so, you know, naturally, that makes sense. Oh, you're a missionary, you should be involved in a lot of ministry. But what they discovered was it was driven by them. So if they didn't do it, then the people didn't meet. And when they went home on furlough, I mean, this is true in a lot of places, things kind of die or slow down. And so they felt like it must be something that kind of keeps on going on its own and grows and continues to grow and bring more people to faith. And one thing they realized was, one key principle was, rather than bring individuals who have no real, and this is, goes back to the earlier article, rather than bringing people who don't really know each other, individuals, gather them together, what they did was, if there's someone who is in open, they focus on that person and their family network. And they kind of invested time in their extended family or social network. And so what happened, I think there was a funny line here. Did I not include that? Pretty much, instead of saying, oh, well, if there are hard times, they just leave, it was more like, your family, you can't leave. And so they continued to share their faith, even if people in their own extended family were critical or opposed what they were doing. It was their family, you know, you're still stuck with each other, or you're still family. And so they continue to share their faith and connect continuously, even despite opposition from their relatives and family members. And over time, it became a natural fellowship of believers. And even if not everyone was a believer, there were enough people in their extended family network that they continued to encourage each other and share their faith with each other. And so, their commitments to each other preceded their faith. Members could no more easily leave the church than they could leave their family. I mean, it was their family, good and bad. And so another principle they discovered as they're working through scripture, as they're thinking through all their church planting ministries, is from the example of Jesus and the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well, and realizing that a lot of the forms, the worship forms, the locations, and so forth and so on, you know, they weren't awful or bad, but they were somewhat restrictive. And so focusing on bringing the gospel to people, even from different backgrounds, different ethnic, and even religious backgrounds. The Samaritans were different from the Jews. key principle was Jesus entered their community, and he was the savior of the world, not just the Jews. And in a similar way to how they worked within this Muslim man's family, extended family, Jesus and sharing the gospel with these Samaritans, they continued and grew and shared the gospel with others in their, within their own community. They didn't have to leave their community to share the gospel or to worship. They stayed in their own existing community and continued to share with others in their community. Another principle, and this is used by a lot of church planting ministries, but they say, they use the term, has anyone heard the term a man of peace? Mm-hmm. It's from Luke chapter 10, and when Jesus is instructing his disciples when they go out, you know, they go meet people, and someone who's very open, you know, hospitable or open to your testimony or the gospel, that person is, it doesn't have to be a man, but it could be a woman too, but a person of peace, and spend more time with them. And it goes back to the matrix earlier. Like, if they're really close and anti-faith, anti-Bible, you can spend a lot of time with them, but practically speaking, you know, you could spend more time with someone who's already open. Rather than trying to persuade and convince someone, find someone who's somewhat open and just spend more time with them. That person will be considered a person of peace. And if they're open and, you know, they're willing to hear, they often invite their friends and family as well. If someone's very closed, they may be less willing to invite others because they're already very closed themselves. Why invite people to something you don't agree with? But if someone's open and curious and a seeker, they'll invite other people. And it's not just a new strategy. They glean these principles from Luke chapter 10, how Jesus taught his own disciples how to share the gospel in places where they have not received it. You know, go from place to place until you find someone who is open and spend time with them. Any questions about these two topics? As I said, you'll get these slides, you get this file. Yes?
So if a person is very close, so we just leave him or her alone, or we to let God work on him or her, or try to keep sharing the gospel? Or?
I would say, and I'm taking this from what a lot of missionary organizations do, they would say, spend more time. They wouldn't say leave them and reject them, but just spend more time with someone who's more open. You can continue to pray for the one who's not open. Another way to put it is, I know we're often taught apologetics and arguing and debating with people, but generally speaking, it's far more effective to focus on people who are open already than arguing and debating with people who are closed.
There's a scripture that says, do not throw your pearls to pigs.
Yes.
So they are pigs?
Well,
meaning like the pigs will not cherish the pearls that you're giving them. That's what it means. They're not seeing the value of what you're sharing with them. That's what that.
So if they don't know the value, how can they cherish
They're not willing to receive the pearls that you're giving them. You're saying, I'm giving you pearls, and they're like, they're not interested in it because they're closed. But if you have people who are willing to receive your gift of pearls, the knowledge and the information about who Jesus is, then it's not just throwing it away. That makes sense. Like a wasted gift.
I mean, one way to put it is, going back to this matrix, a lot of people who are closed, they would be like in the area of J. And thinking, people in J want to study the Bible with me. Maybe they do, but generally, you kind of have to wait until they're like K or L. And so, yeah, praying for them, you know, continuing your friendship with them, those are still good things, but it's more effective to wait until they become more open. And some ways that people have found to be true is often when people have a crisis, like a family or health crisis, or something happens and they're distraught, or, you know, they just, having a friend there really helps them. And even a friend, even though they may not seem open to the gospel, having a friend who prays for them, they appreciate. One example is a group in Texas, and you know, I thought, oh, Texas, that's like the Bible Belt, but they went door to door, and instead of saying, do you believe in Jesus, what they did door to door was they rang the bell, knocked on the doors, and said, do you want us to pray for anything? They just started with that. They didn't say, do you believe in Jesus, or are you going to hell? You know, those things really aren't helpful initially, but they started with, do you want us to pray for anything? And they found that was very effective in opening hearts and people's minds about issues of faith in the gospel. Starting with, are you going to hell or going to heaven, wasn't very helpful in starting the conversation. But yeah, even just having someone pray for them, they found to be. So even prayer could help people move from J to L. In a lot of areas, what they do is community development projects, service projects. And you know, a lot of people would say, oh, well, I want to share the gospel. I want to start and have people go up here, quadrant C. But realistically, practically speaking, a lot of times, you're in quadrant A, in like the J and K, and you kind of have to move them to L or M before you start really getting into scripture. Does that make sense?
Okay, what you're saying is you have to move horizontally to the right in J rather than vertically into the knowledge.
I mean, theoretically, people in J and part of K, really, they want to argue. They want to prove you wrong. And so you're not going to get anywhere with someone. You might. God might do something amazing, but that would be God's call. Or if you start with spending time with them, praying for them, being a person of peace, if you will, for that person, then they may move over and they may not. It depends. I mean, it does depend, I think. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it depends culturally as well. There's different cultures have different ways of going about things. And knowing where you are and knowing what God is doing and how God is moving in that area and finding that person of peace, finding someone who's willing to be with you and talk with you and is open to the gospel is going to be a lot easier than starting with someone who's all the way over in J and wants to argue with you, which is fun and fine, but chances of them moving horizontally is lower.
Okay, one thing I think this is, I mean, the chapter today is talking about like church planting and strategy, kind of, and biblically based strategy of what we're going to do. So I think that, and it's also kind of use of resources in an effective way, and kind of trying to target things like trying to target like lower hanging fruit that is more ripe for targeting. But at the same way, I think kind of, you know, on a personal level, I think if people, you know, somebody like our family member may be in A, and God may give us a conviction that one of our roles is to just tell our parents or tell somebody. And I don't think that means that we don't keep on reaching out to our parents or something, or our family members. I think that's at a very personal level, there may be somebody that God calls us to just keep on praying for and trying and doing everything we can to share the gospel with them in A. And that's probably a little bit different than kind of somebody who we don't know anything about, that we are trying to move a whole group of people towards knowing Christ.
Yes, definitely. I would even say in my own family history, my mother and uncle were the first ones to become believers, and there was a lot of opposition from their families. And yeah, they continued to remain in their family and pray. And yeah, my grandfather, maternal grandfather, was very critical of them, but over time, yeah, exactly.
There's some possibility that just looks like very argumentative, very critical, but sometimes they're also seeking as like an abused Muslim that became Christian. It was very critical in the beginning, but a friend started to talk to him, became a very good Christian.
Yes.
Muslims that become believers, what do they do with Muhammad? What happens to him?
That was one of the topics of the interview research questions. Initially, a lot of them have a very high view of Muhammad, and Jesus and the other prophets are lower. But over time, Jesus becomes more important, and Muhammad becomes less important. Some people have asked, oh, what's their view of Muhammad? And there are different perspectives. Some of them say Muhammad is no longer important to me. The only purpose they would say is from their own studies, pointing to Christ and leading them to Christ, that they're more focused on Christ and the Bible rather than the Quran. others have said things like, oh, historically, Muhammad was pretty much against polytheism, and so on that respect, monotheism. Yeah. But generally speaking, even talking to some of these movement leaders, I would say if they have a very high view, like Muhammad is greater than Jesus, they wouldn't be considered a follower of Jesus. I mean, I would say Islamic groups don't consider them Orthodox Muslims because they're followers of Jesus, not followers of Muhammad. So yeah, I mean, their view of Muhammad is probably higher than what how Christians would view Muhammad. But if they don't believe that Jesus is greater than Muhammad, they wouldn't be considered followers of Jesus. Does that make sense? Then they're just Muslim seekers, not really followers of Jesus. Let me see if there's another. Okay, there's one topic that's, and this is kind of heavy, but this has become an important, this is similar. In a lot of ministries, there's something called the C spectrum, the contextualization scale, and that's become kind of like a shorthand, like a key for what type of ministry. I would say this, our first week in Indonesia, and we had no idea about any of this, someone asked us, so where do you stand, you know, what's your position on the contextualization scale for Muslims? And I had no idea what that meant. I had never even heard the term. And so in the past, 20 years or so, maybe less than 20 years, this has become pretty much what people talk about when they talk about ministry to Muslims, the contextualization. It's kind of an overview summary of ministry to Muslims, but now it also relates to Hindus and Buddhists as well. And so everyone calls it the C spectrum. The author, John Travis, was in Indonesia. I know him and others who work with him. And so, yeah. If you're thinking about ministry to Muslims and even Hindus and Buddhists now, this contextualization scale. And are you familiar with the term contextualization? A simple way to put it is just sharing and communicating the gospel to a group of people in locally appropriate ways. And what locally appropriate means, that's part of the discussion. But what this does is, it's just a descriptive scale of different ministries. And so context C1, meaning contextualization one, but really C1 is like a traditional church using a language different from the daily language of the surrounding, you could take out Muslim surrounding community. So it could be, I mean, this isn't supposed to be a criticism or anything, it's just more of a description. So like an international congregation in China or Indonesia using English, or like even Spanish or Korean, like that's not the local language in the area. And so that would be considered a C1. You know, it's using an international or foreign language and somewhat foreign forms. It's not bad, it's just what it is. And so that's considered. So in Indonesia, which I'm familiar with, it's some of the prop. It would be wearing like a three-piece suit in a tropical country where it's very impractical, but that's what they thought they were supposed to do, using English and organs. And so this is a bhati shirt. Has anyone seen something like this? And so this is a very common, like they use this, for, they wear this for like weddings and professors or teachers wear it for teaching, and even pastors use it when they're preaching. So this is considered formal wear, you know, but it's very comfortable. It's not as hot as a three-piece suit. And so this is an example. If you're wearing a suit, that would be considered more C1. But wearing a local formal, you know, dress or shirt would be considered, yeah, that's more indigenous. And so C1 is, yeah, using a lot of foreign forms, foreign language. C2, it's not bad. It may be appropriate for certain groups in the community, like expatriates or people who are more global. That's what it is. C2 is using the daily language. So it would be, I guess here, Mandarin or maybe one of the other dialects. In Indonesia, it would be Indonesian or one of the other local languages. And But still, even though they use the local language, some of the forms are still somewhat foreign. You know, like if you use organs, that's not an indigenous musical instrument, but yeah. Any questions? I mean, you have, there are examples of these types of churches everywhere. So it's not bad, it's just describing what it is.
So maybe some people here can describe, because one of the things I've always kind of puzzled me is how come there are so many Chinese nationals at HCC? Because we're a C1 church, right? And I guess from perspectives, it seemed to me that most Chinese nationals would prefer a C2, C3, or C4.
You can also Chinese
nationals. I know. So why do Chinese nationals prefer to
there's three
to worship at a C1? Because I see that a lot. And also I'm kind of curious, would it be true in other, is it just specifically to China, or is it also be true in Indonesia, that given the choice between, let's say, a C3 and a C1?
We found that generally in Indonesia, there's some international congregations as well. They're not official churches because they're not registered as well. And they're often at Christian international schools where the families are allowed. Really, it's a Bible study for the children, and the parents observe, but we found that some Indonesians do attend, and part of it is some of them are already Christians, but they want to make international connections, not in a bad way, and some of them just want to improve their English in a worship setting. I mean, it's not they don't have very negative reasons for it, but we also found that some of them are becoming more global, and so it's just their workplace, they have a lot of international connections anyway, so just a natural extension of that. Is that similar here in Shanghai? I don't know.
I can share something. I went to the local church, but I cannot get used to the environment because they just push people to believe in Jesus. So I cannot get used to this one.
So they're more confrontational? You say push people. Actually, we had our Chinese.
Because I came from Chinese, local church is hosted by Korean missionary. Yeah, they have a very strong foundation because they focus on Bible study.
I mean, there are different reasons that people could, be drawn to even a C1 church, like an international congregation. I attended an international fellowship. Even in the U.S., I go to English-speaking churches, even though I'm from a Korean background. And so, that would be an inverse.
we have a Chinese tutor, and she was commenting that one of her other students, or I don't know how it came up, but she had taken an Alpha class. She's not a believer. And she commented that the Chinese Alpha, this is to reach non-believers, was, as you described, kind of pushy. And it was pushy, I guess, would be a good.
And the teacher mentioned about some people, they may be need to sow in watering and reaping. But in Chinese, he gave you a lot of knowledge. It's not about, it's not kind of the blood on the guy. You cannot feel that way.
Not true. I would say, I think in every culture, there might be congregations like that. It's not just, people in the Korean church sometimes feel that way too. So it depends on each congregation and ministry. Sorry, I just want to jump ahead because a lot of the articles refer to the C scale. If you don't understand the scale, then it's very confusing. And a lot of mission agencies also refer refer to the scale as to what their guidelines are. And so it's just helpful to have some understanding. And feel free to ask questions, because now we get to the more contextualized ministries. And C3 is using just local forms, local culture. And so it could be music, instead of using like organs, or even these days, I would say a guitar or a piano. What they would use is local instruments, local music. And so partly, there's a whole field called ethnomusicology, and now they're going to ethno-arts, where using local musical forms and art forms and dance, just so people feel like they don't have to become like a European or an American or, you know, Korean or whatever to worship God. You know, there's nothing inherently biblical about a piano. They didn't exist back then. I mean, you know, it's a kind of, yeah, funny way, amusing way of putting it. But, yeah, some people, because, especially in, like, places in Africa and, like, Southeast Asia, they're starting to use more and more local music, and it's been very helpful in reaching out to, the way I often would put it is, in a lot of, like, major cities, like, global cities, they're so international, so cosmopolitan that any, you know, like, pop music or Christian contemporary music or praise music, it's all just part of their lifestyle, really. But in a lot of outlying areas, they're more traditional, and so it's just weird.
When you go to any of the malls here, you'll hear American music in the background.
Yeah. That could be why this is an attractive setting for some. Like, this is a comfortable setting for some people to worship in, just because that's a daily life reality of living in Shanghai. Whereas you were saying, if we were going to one of the provinces, then we would probably need to be much more contextualized.
Exactly. Another example is, in a lot of like rural villages, they don't have bread, they don't have grape juice or wine. So when they have communion, they use like sticky rice and like fruit juice. And that's, I mean, some people might have an issue with that, but considering the practical limitations, they want to have communion to commemorate the Lord's Supper, but they don't have ready access, easy access to bread and wine. And so, yeah, fruit juice or sticky rice has been used in like villages in Thailand. So that's just an example of just using something local.
We did it in Bangkok.
Because it's, the understanding is, and what a lot of Muslims would say is, if you look historically or even some of the descriptions in the Bible, a lot of the worship forms and prayer forms are closer to what they're doing than what a lot of contemporary churches are doing. That's the argument they would make. Like, yeah, praying as you're prostrate, yeah, as you're kneeling. So
I think contextualization is really important, especially as we're moving more and more into the 1040 window. I think it can be, I mean, as someone, I've been through Perspectives twice, that's why I said I've done the readings, I've done them again recently and things like that. I think contextualization is one of the only ways that we're going to get some of those far outreaching people groups that we've never even heard of until the day God says, oh, guess what, you're going here. And I don't think we should make it harder than it should be. I mean, I think there are very important elements of the Bible that should be followed and things that we should do, but I think one of the ways that the contextualization is beautiful, because God has put something in a people group that we wouldn't have discovered about God if we hadn't gone to that people group. And I think that should be celebrated and rejoiced in, instead of told, no, you must have bread and wine and you must do it this way.
Now, C3, yeah, a lot of the local cultural forms, that's considered C3, and most mission agencies and, yeah, even denominations these days, you know, they incorporate different local things, like local dress, local clothing, you know, sometimes local music, you know. Sometimes they would have hymns and contemporary songs that are translated into your language, but then they would also have other songs using like local melodies and local instruments. So that's, yeah, C3. Now C4, what you were mentioning, is when it becomes more Islamic, if you will, or if you're in a Hindu context, more Hindu or more Buddhist. And so they use forms that they consider compatible with the Bible, but yet different. And some of the Muslim followers of Jesus would say they're actually closer to the biblical descriptions of how they prayed and so forth and so on. Even we're working through the Old Testament historical books, and after Solomon, you know, built the temple, he instructed the people of Israel to pray towards the temple. And so, you know, there are similarities. They're not, it doesn't mean, oh, Muslims can do whatever they want, but there are enough similarities where some of the things we criticize Muslims, you know, when you look at historically what's happening in the Bible and during those times, a lot of similarities. Doesn't mean that, yeah, they can just,
I mean, also looking at the idea of the followers of Esau the Messiah, I think is, at least as an American, growing up in that society where you say you're a Christian and that's the only thing that you say. And I think in that context, in a Muslim context, follower of Esau the Messiah is going to mean a lot more to the community than it will to say, oh, I'm a Christian, I'm foreign, I'm doing something completely different against all of our culture and all of our ideas. And I mean, having been in Thailand and several other places, seeing people who adopt a culturally contextualized saying, I am a follower of Christ, in a way that makes more sense to the community and makes a bigger impact to the community, it's really powerful. I've seen it a few times, and it's incredibly powerful to see people who still say they're a follower of Christ, but they use a different word and they use a different name that's contextualized to the community.
I would also add, I was surprised by this. I don't know if it's true in other places like China or Korea. I haven't heard it in Korea yet. But in the U.S., I hear more and more sermons referring to Christ follower or Jesus follower than Christian. And I thought it came from people hearing it from like mission agencies or missionaries. But and I've heard several people say that it started with Tim Keller. Mm-hmm. So a lot of pastors in urban settings have started using the term Christ follower Jesus follower, because they feel like, especially in New York City, where the term Christian has all these negative connotations. It's also the same in my experience in Indonesia and other places. A lot of Muslims, when they hear Christian, this is the paradox. They're interested in they're curious about the Bible. They want to learn more about Jesus, the ones who are open. But they're very anti-Christian. And what, as we've got to know them, a lot of it is they have a lot of misconceptions about Christianity, and they equate the Christian West. And what they mean by that is the Crusades and Hollywood. And you kind of have to tell them, you know, Christians in America are very anti-Hollywood, generally speaking. But they see Hollywood as Christianity. And so it's, yeah. There are a lot of similar issues. But when you talk about Jesus in the Bible, they are open. We had one European colleague in Sumatra, and an Islamic leader came up to me and said, you Christians don't revere Jesus enough. And he was like, what are you talking about? He said, you know, and they said, this is what we Muslims believe about Jesus, and, you know, all these things. And my European colleague was like, let's have a conversation. Let's study scripture together. Because it was strange that this Muslim thought Christians weren't glorifying Jesus enough, which is Christianity, yeah, follower of Christ. But C4 is just using praying like this rather than like this. Praying, kneeling, keeping the Ramadan fast. Some of them do that. And they explain, they're fasting and praying to Jesus. And so this is where it gets, I'll be honest with you, there's a lot of discussion. Some mission agencies and denominations don't agree with this. Others, you know, that this is as far as they're willing to go. This is kind of like their limit. And so some of the articles you'll read will be discussing these issues. And they, when asked by Muslims, they don't use it, a lot of them don't use the term, I'm a Christian. They say, I'm a follower of Jesus. So, now, this is where a lot of the controversy comes. C5 is, instead of saying, I'm only a follower of Jesus, they say, I'm a Muslim follower of Jesus. And so, it's kind of tough. C4 and C5 are very close, but it's somewhat of an identity issue. They still want to retain their Muslim identity. And part of it is, they don't say, I'm an Islamic follower of Jesus. No one would consider that to make sense. They'd say, I'm a Muslim follower of Jesus. And so there's a lot of overlap between Islam and Muslim. You know, to us, it would mean the same thing. But for them, Islam is very clear and specific. And Muslim is, I guess the equivalent would be like a secular Jew. You know, they want to retain like their, but they don't really believe. And so they're not really an Islamic follower of Jesus. They're a Muslim follower of Jesus. And again, this is, you know, there are lots of discussions and debates about this. Going back to David's question, it would be like, are you a follower of Muhammad? Well, if you're a follower of Muhammad, you can't be a follower of Jesus. You know, there's kind of like a spectrum. And if you're a follower of Muhammad, you're not considered a follower of Jesus. And then if you're a follower of Jesus, then you're not really Islamic. I know this sounds like a semantic issue, but that's how they view it. One of the explanations given is the Muslim community is not just religious, it's also cultural, and it's their family network. So they would consider themselves part of the Muslim community, but a follower of Jesus. And I know this sounds almost the same, but I've never heard anyone say they're an Islamic follower of Jesus. To them, that's different. That's a very tough issue. Any questions?
So the last sentence where it says see themselves as Muslims who follow Isa the Messiah, that's the name of Jesus that they use.
Yeah, Isa is Jesus in the Quran, and Messiah, Al-Masih. So they would often say Isa Al-Masih. And I'll give one example. For a long time, people thought this is just Christian missiologists, Christian missionaries kind of making up this fake idea. But nowadays, even in Islamic Muslim areas, they don't see this as normal. They see this as very, some people would say they're heretics, Muslim heretics, others would say they're just unorthodox. But in our part of Indonesia, someone we know gave his testimony about this at a Korean church in Malaysia. And the Korean church member said, this is just bizarre. So they asked the cleaning lady, who coincidentally happened to be from the same ethnic group, people group, and they asked her, so this person's saying you can be a Muslim follower of Jesus. Do you think this is possible? And she said, for a long time, it was not possible. But recently, there are now Muslim followers of Muhammad and Muslim followers of Jesus in our community. And she had no connection to this person. She just said, it's just starting to happen. And part of the reason is, some of the commentaries from the medieval period were very open to Jesus. And so it's kind of like, when pastors refer to commentaries and, when you read articles, you have to have commentary support. And so for Indonesian Muslims and probably Muslims in other areas, if they go to some of the Quranic commentaries written before the Crusades, they have their own commentary support to be a follower of Jesus. It's a minority view, a very small minority view.
Do you think that the C4 churches are able to fly under the radar a little bit more? Because, at the end here it said that unsaved Muslims may see C5 believers as theologically deviant and may eventually expel them from the community of Islam. Do you think that there's a little bit more by just saying you're a follower of Isa versus of following a follower of Jesus versus saying I'm a Muslim follower of Jesus? Do you think that there's a big difference in the contextualization there? Do you think that just by flat out saying I'm a follower of Christ, the community sees you differently? What's your experience?
What they've explained is it's C4 is kind of similar to Messianic Jews.
Yeah.
So Messianic Jews are Jews for Jesus, but Orthodox Jews or the larger Jewish community don't see Messianic Jews as part of the Jewish community. They see them as people who've left, but aren't fully Christian, but they're kind of in between. That's what we've heard. And so C4 people, C4 Muslims, followers of Jesus, would be kind of there. They're not considered Muslims. They're just kind of in between. That's how Muslims generally would view them. And C5 Muslim followers of Jesus would be considered more like, they're Muslims, but they're not really Orthodox. And over time, like as it says here, they will be pushed out.
Yeah.
There is a question, how stable long-term are any of these things? And so there are lots of discussions and debates. Can you continue being a C4 fellowship for generations? Same thing with C5. And the majority view, even among people working with these movements, eventually these C4 and C5 groups will become more and more similar to Christian groups over time. But there are others who believe you can maintain this for generations. And so that's it would be similar to the Messianic Jews.
Mm-hmm.
So, I know this is a really heavy topic, it's technical, but when you read about anything about Muslim ministry these States, these themes, these topics have become part of the discussion. And for a lot of mission agencies, they'll have guidelines too. I think one organization would say C4 and no more, meaning they only go as far as C4. C6, I think it's similar context in the sense that they're just secret believers. They don't really tell people they're followers of Jesus. You know, it could be their family or as individuals, and they're secretly believers. They just don't tell anyone. And I would think it's similar to what happened in China decades ago.
Or even now, Communist Party members who are believers.
Yes.
Right? Communist parties who are believers, they can't be open. They can't say that they were baptized, or they won't get baptized in fear of.
They can be baptized, I mean, secret.
Yes.
But they still go to a party.
No, that's true. I mean, okay. No, that's good. I mean, we hear stories of people, in China as well as a lot of other countries, like Muslim countries where government leaders, even the rumors of in some countries like the royal family, you know, some of them are secret believers. And so,
Is that okay? Because in the Bible it said we have to admit God.
Do not be ashamed.
Yeah.
I won't be.
I'm confused.
I mean, people have different perspectives on this. Some people would say you have to immediately publicize your faith. Other people would say because of circumstances, maybe you can share your faith or that you're a believer to people in your close community, like families, your family or your friends, but not everyone else. And to give one example, we're working with someone who. In Bible translation. He's from a Muslim background. He became a believer, but his family didn't fully understand. And for a long time, he didn't really involve them. But over time, I mean, I thought it would take months, but it took years for him to involve his family members and relatives in the Bible translation process, like asking them for feedback, having them study. Like, now he's giving them Bibles to his family members and relatives. But that took years. And so I use that as I thought he could do it sooner, but he just needed more time. So, I mean, that's my perspective on his particular circumstance. He just needed more time.
It's a complicated issue. I mean, when you're talking about, I have a few friends, one in Thailand and one in the U.S., who grew up in very Muslim communities, and one of them chose to tell her family, and her family threatened to kill her and a whole bunch of other things. Like, there is so much complication behind this personally and, like, the ramifications in the community. I mean, yeah, C6 is not ideal, but I think God moves in people over time. And I think, I mean, even here in China, the first time I came to China in 2005, we went to an underground community church, and it was amazing in Beijing. And I have never met, I've met some of the most incredible Chinese believers. I'm not in contact with them because we were a danger to them at the time. And many of them were in this type of situation, and some of them were Communist Party members. Some of them were just believers that they would be killed, they would be arrested. There was so much complication behind that issue. I think it's not ideal, but I saw over time a few of them I have kept in contact with, and they're now pastors of very large churches in Beijing. And so I think God moves in people in time. And I think he will make it very clear if they're his own when they need to step forward. And I've seen many people do that.
I'll just add that obviously in China it's happened, but also in Hindu and Buddhist contexts, there's similar issues going on. I think generally most people talk about Islamic persecution, but in certain parts of the Buddhist world and certain parts of the Hindu world, they're encountering similar opposition and persecution. We have to finish by 10?
10,
okay. Any questions? I'll quickly go over a case study in Indonesia.
Rick, can you also talk about Western China?
Oh, yeah. It's the case study in Indonesia relates to Western China because there are a lot of similarities. It's pretty much the Islamic Quranic school system where they studied the Quran, but now they're open to scripture. And I didn't realize this because I didn't think Islamic schools were allowed, but there are a small number of them that are permitted, and they have similar issues. But any questions about the C scale? And it's kind of a heavy topic, and my initial encounter with C-scale was being questioned in our first week before we even we completed our orientation to legal issues and practical issues. And so it was kind of an overwhelming topic at the time. And I know it's a lot of information and it's heavy, but today when you're talking about ministry to Muslims, the C-scale is pretty much kind of like the code of what different ministries are doing, and it's also being applied to Muslim and Buddhist ministries as well. So if it's, yes.
So one question I have, so you're talking about Messianic Jews, and Jews for Jesus, right? Mm-hmm. So are they like a C4, is that what they're?
Yes, C4. There actually are Orthodox followers of Jesus that remain in the synagogue. But someone I know who is involved in that type of ministry said the way they view it is, you know, publicly it seems like the issue is, was Jesus the Messiah? Is Jesus the Messiah? But these Orthodox followers of Jesus, some of them are rabbis, have explained that it's really the issue isn't being a follower of Jesus, which kind of shocked me when I heard it. It's that they're remaining in the synagogue in their Jewish community. And I still haven't fully figured that out, because when you hear a lot of people, like, you know, especially in New York, when a lot of Jewish people talk about Jews for Jesus, they're very critical of them. And so, yeah, there actually are, yeah, Orthodox followers of Jesus. They do encounter persecution and opposition, but in their Jewish communities, in their synagogue communities, they're still accept. That's what they say. I think the biggest theme or principle that they've explained was remaining in their community and maintaining relationships with people in their community. Oftentimes when maybe Jews for Jesus, some of them would be very aggressive about criticizing the synagogue or rabbis or, you know, Judaism, and that's seen as being very hurtful, and that kind of pushes them away from the community. But again, that's just as much as I know about Jewish situation.
Because born in New York, so a lot of different folks that I've known, not that many, but a few, who explain like the old, you know, Christian, like I consider them to be Christians and followers of Christ. But they explain, you know, they use a lot of like the Passover, and they explain it in kind of a Christian sense, and it seems to make a lot of sense. So it's kind of like biblically acceptable Jewish practices are utilized, right? And that's, and I think that makes it, it celebrates their sense of being like Jewish, or, you know, but also honors Christ. So I think that is, I learned a lot.
That's a very good point. Some of the followers of Jesus would say, in a similar way, the Quran kind of alludes to biblical faith, and so they need to go back to the New Testament, which they haven't had. And so that's the explanation they would give in that way. Like, Jews would be pointing that way, but Muslim followers of Jesus would be pointing back, if that makes sense. But I'll give a quick case study. And it relates to Muslim groups in China, a lot of similarities. So there's a news article that I'm going to send, that I sent the link to David, that describes some of these similarities. Okay, so it's pretty much about the Islamic school system, the Quranic school system in Indonesia. And you don't have to take any notes. This is just a case study, but the news article about China would be more relevant and concrete. And so they're pretty much just Islamic schools. And what happens at a young age, and I'll just jump the gun and say, this reminds me of a lot of our New York Jewish kids going to Hebrew school. There's, you know, memorized verses, they learn basic Arabic, you know. I mean, they're not fluent, but they value learning Arabic to study the Quran. So young people, my wife was studying basic Arabic, and our cleaning lady, and we know she doesn't get paid a lot because we pay our part-time salary, she kind of laughed and told my wife, my 7-year-old daughter knows more Arabic than you. And, you know, we know she's not well off because she's working as a cleaning lady for us. But just shows that in certain devout Muslim areas, the value of having their children learn Arabic and the Quran. And so what they would do is, you know, they go to regular public school, and then they would have madrasa, which is just, you know, religious Islamic instruction. And then in the evenings, they would do the chanting. A lot of times people think they don't learn anything, but chanting's, the analogy I would give is, you know, like a lot of Jewish prayers, you know, they're chanted, the monks would chant. It's similar. It's just the initial studies. But what they would do is they would start studying texts, and one-on-one, the religious instructor would have them read the Quran in Arabic or commentary, and then kind of it would translate it into Indonesian, one of the local languages. And the reason why I'm pointing all this out is I would recently discovered their similarities in northwest China. I mean, there are these things. And then they would have a large group where the instructor would teach and explain a lot of the, yeah, the Quran and commentaries. And then advanced students would have a seminar course. So they would study heavier topics, the deeper topics. All this is to say, the general misconception is students in the madrasa system or Islamic school system, they don't learn anything, they're just memorizing. But that's just kind of like the first step. It's kind of like when you learn math, you start with memorizing arithmetic, you know, multiplication tables, and then you move on to more advanced topics. And the goal of these Islamic schools isn't mass education. They're trying to identify their future Islamic leaders. And so it's more similar to rabbinic training. A lot of similarities. In Indonesia, some of the Indonesian leaders, and I can't believe they would say this, cited a former Indonesian president when asked what his favorite novel is, which My Name is Asher Love. What kind of Muslim leader talks about it, you know, a book about a Hasidic Jew as his favorite book? But he said that because there are a lot of similarities with their religious training and Islamic training. And so there's similarities in China, but there's some of these things. So what they would do is they would have Arabic, and then they would use a modified Arabic script for Indonesian or one of the local languages. And the reason why I point this out is I discovered there are similar texts and commentaries in some of the Chinese dialects. And so, yeah, this is a commentary. They have the Arabic Quran in Arabic, and then in Javanese, one of the largest minority languages in Indonesia, using an Arabic script and commentary on the side and bottom. And this is very similar to what the Talmud looks like in terms of formatting, the Jewish Talmud. This is the Quran using Indonesian, and then they have an interlinear. You know, like how their Hebrew, Old Testament interlinear is Hebrew and then English or Chinese or Spanish. Same thing with the New Testament in Greek. They do similar things, the Arabic, the Quran in Arabic. And so, Uyghur script is an example, but Jawi script is Indonesian languages using a modified Arabic script. If you have a smartphone, it's one of the options. Definitely on the, I was really glad when, for Mac OS, they started using it. It helped a lot with our work. That's what, 10.6, 10.5. But there's a history of Bible translations going back centuries. And when we discovered this, this is Matthew chapter 1, done by a, yeah, it looks very Islamic, doesn't it? This was done over 100 years ago, and there's some that go back to the 14th, 15th century in a similar way. This was done by a Dutch missionary translator. And so, yeah, their translations historically, their historic translations that are like this. A lot of the Arabic translations, they don't have all the calligraphy, but they have similar features. Arabic translations, even for Christians, they use a lot. Yeah, well, they use Arabic script. Sometimes they have text borders because it shows that, you know, this is the holy text. They kind of, when they see, you know, Christian Bibles, like a study Bible would be black leather. When they see that, it kind of connotes, indicates like death. So it's not very appealing to them. But if they have like colorful, usually like green or red with gold embossed lettering, Arabic calligraphy is more meaningful to them. Now, as they're there's a group in Pakistan that found this Bible, but as they were looking through the historical records, they discovered that one of the early translations done in India, 1745, they used a modified Arabic script, which eventually became Urdu script. And so there's this huge controversy. How could you use Arabic script for the Bible? But some of the Indonesian Malay translations done before, and surprisingly financed by the Dutch East Indies Company, they used a modified Arabic script for their translation and became the historical precedent for their early Urdu translations. Now, you know, it's a non-issue, but back then it was a huge controversy. This is an Arabic translation of the Gospels and Acts. And so you can see the gold embossed text border and calligraphy. This is my part of the story. I received an early copy in May 2008. I just gave it to some people we knew, some Muslim instructors, just to get feedback. And this Muslim instructor was very, other people have tried to share the gospel with this Muslim instructor and not interested, often telling people, I don't want to see that person again, family members and friends. But when given this particular translation with all the different features, the response was, and this was a surprise to me, I want to share this with other Islamic scholars and instructors. And I explained, well, this is the gospel. I want to share this. I said, this is the Christian Bible. I want to share this. And it was kind of a shock because, I'll be honest. Initially, I thought, oh, it's somewhat of a gimmick. I mean, nice cover.
Just because it was in red and gold.
Yeah, but and in Arabic script, or Arabic, I guess. Once you get through the content, you know, it's definitely the gospels, but... And so, a year later, in May 2008, I was encouraged, but I thought it was an isolated incident. 10-10, I'll go through this really quickly. 2008, they're Muslim followers of Christ who were kind of sharing their faith. And I gave them two copies, and months later, they started teaching from the Arabic Gospels in the Islamic school system. And then they formed an organization registered with the government to promote the study of the former holy books, the Torah, the Psalms, and the Gospels in Quranic schools. And it's 10 years later, and I hear it's still going on. They face opposition and persecution, but it's still going on. And the people I gave it up in May 2008, they're still continuing to give it to people, Islamic theological instructors and family members, and people are still receiving it. And so, it's not publicized, but it's not in secret either. It's kind of in the middle there. Sorry, kind of went over. But the reason why I say this is, even though this is in Indonesia, there are similar things happening in other parts, and as the Islamic school system is similar to, there aren't as many, but there are similar schools in Northwest China. And there'll be an article kind of giving an overview of this.
Any questions? Okay, let me close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your work throughout the world and this difficult task of moving people in a different culture to know you and what that means. And I ask you to give us wisdom on how to do that. Pray for your work among the people, particularly those that are far away, that do not have the knowledge and who are opposed. Give us wisdom on how to move them to you. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So next week, I think we're back to 7 and 8. Lessons 7 and 8.
Yeah, today is 14.
Today was 14.
Why
are we so advanced? To accommodate the instructor's schedule. I'm not sure it was bumps. Yeah. So.
Yeah, I didn't know.
Yeah, you didn't know. I think it was maybe our 7 and 8 schedule. Instructor.